Hi, this is a short video on some of the first objects that I made using the maskless wafer stepper. Now, as you may know from the previous videos, I've built a machine to make tiny optical elements, and I already showed some of the lens patterns that I made. But the big question, of course, is, do they work? So last weekend I was testing the quality of the photolithography patterns, and just by accident I found out that they actually work already, with basically just a photoresist layer and nothing else. So hopefully I can share with you some of the initial excitement and amazement that I felt when I first saw these lenses in action. Here you see the patterns of a few diffractive lenses under a microscope. And as one of my viewers pointed out, they are actually called Fresnel zone plates. Now, although quite detailed, I must stress that these do not have the same resolution as a true metasurface lens. Let's say, real metasurface lenses have a resolution that is about an order of magnitude higher, and they generally are made using e-beam lithography, not optical lithography. As you can see, they don't look like a normal lens, and they don't operate like a normal lens. So in a normal lens, you use the principle of refraction. So the light changes direction on the curved surfaces of two media that have a different refractive index, like air and glass. But the diffractive lenses are completely flat, and their thickness is less than a micron. Now, the optical behavior is defined by a very thin layer that is on top of the glass. So in my case, the layer contains a variable grating of lines that actually diffract the light in the direction of a focal point. Now, I should add that this type of diffractive lenses do not only focus the light towards a specific focal point, but also under the opposite angle. And this means that they also have a virtual aerial image on the other side of the lens, basically just like a negative lens has. The lenses are very small, and they have a surface area of approximately 1/6 of a square millimeter. So you have to put them under a microscope in order to look at the details. And by the way, the text in the image, which covers about 1/5 of the lens, is there so I can easily match each lens pattern with a specific set of exposure parameters after development of the patterns. Now, here's a schematic of the configuration that I used to look at them. The illumination source is a white LED, and it's a few centimeters below the sample, which contains the lens pattern. And from above, I examine the results using a microscope equipped with a CCD camera. Now, let me show you what I saw when I looked at these patterns for the first time. Now, when I had placed the sample under the microscope, I did not have my focus in the right position. It was actually about 1 millimeter too high. And the first thing I saw were these bright square patches, which I did not immediately recognize. So I brought down the focal point of my microscope and found the lens pattern. And as you can see, it's quite detailed. But then I realized that I had seen the shape of these bright squares before. They actually looked like the shape of the LED below the lens, which I used to illuminate the samples. Now, basically, I recognized the two distinct electrode connections, which are on the LED. So when I refocused, I saw that I had actually been looking at a 40 times demagnified aerial image of the original LED. Now, keep in mind that these aerial images are extremely small. The image area of the LED is only 1/100 of a square millimeter. Next to my microscope, I had these violet LEDs lying around, which are more or less monochromatic, and they have a maximum emission at 405 nanometers. So when you have a diffractive lens, using monochromatic light is actually an advantage for the sharpness, as I will discuss later. But the nice thing is that these LEDs have a pattern in the surface. So as you can see, they consist of 9 individual smaller emitters. So I replaced the white LED with this one, and sure enough, it gave me a very clear image of the LED showing the 9 individual areas. And you can even make out the electrode structure on the surface of each individual emitter. There is another interesting thing here. So when you use diffraction as a method to create a focal plane, you get the clearest image when there is a phase difference of 1 wavelength between two adjacent grooves in the grating. And in this condition, there is actually constructive interference. However, this also occurs with a difference of 2 or even 3 lambda, and we call this higher order diffraction. Now, if you look really carefully at the images and scan the microscope from the lens surface to the first order focal point, you can actually quite easily make out the third and second order projections. And they're just smaller versions of the original because of the increased numerical aperture, and they're actually much less clear. But still, you can easily observe them. So how cool is that? Now, just for fun, I want to show you this exotic little lens that I made, which actually has two focal points instead of just one. And sure enough, it also shows you these first and higher order focal planes. But instead of just one, it displays two projections of the LED simultaneously. And because the two optical axes of this lens are very close together, both images are actually overlapping. For now, I will leave it to your own imagination what you can do with this type of device, but I hope I will be able to demonstrate to you a fascinating application in the future. As I mentioned before, using monochromatic light has advantages for the sharpness, so I want to briefly explain this. In white light, you have a range of wavelengths, and they are not diffracted under the same angle. I mean, that's the whole point of optical gratings, right? To separate the different light colors on purpose. But here it's actually not desired when you want to create a high quality image. I'll show you the effects of chromatic dispersion using the two focal point lens. Now, I made a small white illumination spot by reflecting the light from the LED off a ball bearing ball. And because the illumination spot is so much smaller, the image is actually much darker. You can barely make out the diffractive pattern in this image. But this is what we observe when the focal point of the microscope is moved away from the lens surface. Now, if you carefully examine the spots in the two focal points, you can actually observe this chromatic dispersion as the spots change their color from red to blue. In fact, multiple times, because we observe these effects over at least 4 orders of diffraction. So, to conclude this video, I find it pretty amazing that you can make these high quality projections with just a relatively crude diffraction pattern. And I'm basically just starting to discover what's possible with these type of devices. Now, if you have any suggestions yourself on what kind of devices to make in the future, your ideas are very welcome. So, please do not hesitate to leave a comment in the comment section.